outside and please make sure all electronics are turned off and put away.
Please be seated, everyone. Good morning.
Good morning.
Gentlemen, I've been advised that there's a grand jury report out that we have to make here first. I will call the case on People versus Anthony Saccone. Could we have Mr. Saccone out, please? Mr. Saccone is present. I just want to make the record clear that he's present with counsel, Mr. Scharf, as well as Mr. Fitzpatrick, Mr. Podnarski from the DA's office. Also, our court officers have made every effort to make the courtroom open to everyone who wishes to attend to be here today. The courtroom is obviously very full. Every seat is filled, as well as people are standing in the back, which we don't normally allow, but we are doing under these circumstances. So we've made every effort we can for this to be an open courtroom. Also, there's a media request to cover today's proceedings. Mr. Sharp, do you wish to be heard on that?
Briefly, Your Honor, I just request that any argument in relation to the integrity of the grand jury proceeding or any defects in the grand jury proceeding be heard by the court outside the presence of the media.
I understood, Mr. Fitzpatrick.
I have no objection to media coverage.
Under the circumstances, at this stage of the proceeding, the court is granting the media request for audio and visual coverage. The first order of business is the motion to renew or reconsider the motion to withdraw the guilty plea made by Mr. Scharf. The court has considered, it is debatable whether or not, and there would be a point of argument whether or not it should be couched as a motion to renew or reconsider. But in any event, the court has reconsidered that motion to reconsider the motion to withdraw the guilty plea and the substance therein, including by incorporation, all of the arguments made in both the first motion, the second motion, the subsequent pro se motions, as well as the court received an addendum filed by Ms. Rizzo Friday that was forwarded to the court on Friday, an affidavit in support of the motion to withdraw the plea. The court has considered all of these matters as well as the people's response thereto, and the court is again denying the motion to withdraw the plea. So that is denied. We are proceeding forward with sentencing today. Mr. Fitzpatrick, to the people move sentence.
People move sentence, Your Honor.
You wish to be heard further regarding sentencing?
I do. Good morning again, Judge. Indictment 2018-250, July 25th, 2018. The matter is on for sentencing this morning, and as I just said, the people move sentence. Initially, Judge, with your permission, I would just like to briefly thank the men and women of the New York State Police who are the lead agency on this case, particularly Investigator Joe Whitener, who has been with me since February in putting this case together in a very thorough and meticulous manner. We would not be here but for him. And I also would like to express my appreciation to the Geddes and Camillus Police Departments, the Sheriff's Office, the first responders, and all of those who responded to the scene and quite frankly treated each victim in this case as if it was a member of their own family. I would like to, before concluding my remarks, I would like to, pursuant to the notice that we provided to the court, present four family members to speak on behalf of the three victims in this case. First, I would ask Sadita Almich to speak on behalf of her sister, Sam.
Good morning, ma'am.
My name is Sadita. I am Sam's oldest sister. How do you begin to express in words how one person's actions and choices have destroyed your family's life? How do you explain to people that one's individual choices and actions have changed your lives forever? February 23rd, 2018, stay with us for as long as we live. The day I learned my younger sister was killed by a drunk driver. 10 days after our mother passed away from brain cancer. How do you accept the fact that your loved one is gone at the age of 20? How do you begin to accept that you will never see them again, hear their voice, or get to hug them? Samra was so full of life. She enjoyed everything she did and lived each day to the fullest. You could never have a dull moment when she was around. She would always joke and try to make people around her smile and laugh. Samra had her childhood stolen from her because of bacterial meningitis. She spent her childhood in and out of the hospital. Our summer vacations consisted of Samra having surgery, so she didn't have to miss school, but we made the most of that because we were still all together. Samra was one of the strongest people I have ever known. She overcame so much during her short life, from daily obstacles to bullies. She conquered all of life's struggles with a smile. She was finally done with surgeries at the age of 19. She was ready to be independent and conquer the world. She lived every single second of her independence. She was living her life to the fullest and changing the lives of people she encountered daily for the better. All it took was one conversation with Samra and we were hooked. Her outlook on life and her love for people was one of a kind. Samra was tremendously loved. She knew everyone and everyone knew her. It has been almost 9 months since my sister was taken from us, but I spent every day waiting for a phone call or a surprise visit. Took her away by the decisions you made that night. The anger, frustration, disgust, and hatred I had towards you and your cowardly actions that night hasn't and never will subside. You didn't even give her a chance when you decided to drive almost triple the posted speed limit and run the red light. The fact that you decided to the fact that you left my sister at the roadside like roadkill, as if she didn't have people that cared and loved her, is something we must live with every single day. The fact that she didn't have anyone to comfort her during her last breath breaks our heart and has destroyed my family now. She spent her life being there for family and friends when they needed her, but no one was able to be there for her when she needed it most. You left them alone that cold night. You made a choice that took their lives, and you couldn't even stay at the scene to comfort them during their last moments. I will forever have hatred towards you for that. My sister deserved comfort during that moment. Every human being deserves comfort during their last breath. You decided your injuries that didn't require medical attention were more important than staying at the scene after you knowingly hit another car while driving at an extremely excessive speed. A heartless coward runs from the scene. A human being that commits that crime as an accident stays at the scene, calls 911 and checks on the individuals in the other car. Instead, you decided that running was the best choice. You will never understand how your actions on that cold night haunt us. I think about how things could have been different if you had called 911 the moment it happened. Maybe one of them or all of them would be here with us today. My sister deserved a chance at life. She had so many dreams and aspirations. The day you took her life, you killed her and her chance of finishing college. Finding the love of her life is turning her. tears and sadness because she is gone. And every milestone is another one she can't be a part of. The heartache that accompanies these milestones is indescribable. How do you enjoy life when you realize the one person that would be cheering for you is gone? These milestones are now spent at the cemetery. No one understands the pain of having to visit your daughter, sister, and friend at a cemetery. I have spent countless hours at her gravesite, but the reality of it still doesn't seem real. I just won't begin to understand and accept that your younger sister was killed. How do you grasp the idea that you'll never get to see her or tell her how much you love her? Sarah's laugh was contagious, and I would give anything just to hear her voice one more time, to have one last conversation, and to give her one last hug. I would give the world just to see her smile one more time. She was the glue that kept us all together and strong during life's toughest challenges. She could make you laugh when you least wanted to. Her spirit would light up every room she entered. She's so deeply missed. This life will never be the same without her. Every day since she has been gone is more painful than the day before. Her absence is painful beyond limits. The joy that used to accompany the simple things in life just isn't there anymore. Since the incident, my family has continued to experience a roller coaster of emotions. We think about Sarah every day, and the thought of her is accompanied by tears. Whenever I'm on the road and I see a gypsy in Acadia, I get emotional because it instantly reminds me of Sarah and that you robbed her of her life when you decided to drive at an excessive speed. I reminisce on our past because thinking about the future is extremely difficult, because I must accept the fact that my sister can't be a part of it. I've caused me tremendous pain and suffering since the day you took her life. How would you feel if your loved one was killed and the driver ran from the scene? Put yourself in our position and tell us you deserve to be free and with your family. Tell me you deserve to be out on bail after you've had pictures posted of you drinking, partying, and enjoying life, after you took 3 innocent lives a few months prior. We have had to put up with so many court appearances over these past months because of you. You have tried to weasel yourself out of paying for your actions multiple times. You, your family, friends, and your supporters have continued to claim your heinous actions were an accident. The definition of an accident is something occurring unexpectedly or by chance. You killing Samra, Bailey, and Michael was not an accident. The choices you made that night, drinking, using cocaine, getting behind a wheel, stopping at a red traffic light and signaling near the gas station, waiting for the green light and then driving 86 miles per hour in a 30 mile per hour zone, running a red light, T-boning a car, getting out of your car and knowing where your mother's house was and running to it to hide while delirious, and never once thinking of checking on the victims in the other car or calling 911, is not and never will be the definition of an accident. Your supporters can finally begin to accept that they have spent 9 months supporting a criminal that committed that crime intentionally and not once has apologized to the families. You have had endless opportunities to apologize or even show an ounce of remorse or regret during the past 9 months since the accident. Instead, you have taken every opportunity to show us this is all a big joke to you. From your endless smirks and outbursts in the courtroom, how does a person that claims to be full of guilt and remorse, supposedly thinks of the victims every day, spend 9 months putting the victims' families through hell? You have continued to show us killing our loved ones means nothing to you. The only person you care about is yourself. Our families will get an ounce of justice today, but no time will be enough to overcome the pain of our loss. Even though you will never understand or feel the pain and suffering that you have put my family, as well as Michael's and Bailey's through, I hope that one day you can wake up and accept that your actions and choices on the night of February 23rd, 2018 took 3 innocent lives. Your actions and choices on the night of February 23rd, 2018 destroyed 3 families and affected a countless number of other individuals that knew and loved Samra, Bailey, and Michael. Samra's bright smile, sense of humor, and effect she had on people will live on forever. Your choices that night took the life of my beautiful sister. She was only 20 years old. She had so much to offer to the world, but all that came to an end on February 23rd, 2018, when the car my sister was riding in was T-boned at a speed of approximately 86 miles per hour in a 30 mile per hour speed limit zone. My family and I will spend the rest of our lives fighting to get my sister justice and ensuring that her memory lives on. To the coward and monster that took my sister's life, in mine, in my family's eyes, you will always be a murderer. We will be there every 2 years after the 10-year mark fighting for our loved ones to get justice, because our loved ones deserve that. We love you and miss you so much, Sam.
guest, Jean Scott, who's the mother of Michael Walker, to speak on behalf of her son.
Good morning, ma'am.
Your Honor, I'm not sure how to do this. This is something that a parent should never have to go through. I have had sleepless nights and even worse days trying to cope with the hurt and pain that Anthony Saccone has caused me and my family and countless others. I do not know how to explain to you that being forced to live without my child, my only child, is unbearable. That it's difficult for me to go on with any day without looking for Michael or waiting for Michael to come home or call me. Better yet, FaceTime me, because we did that a lot. We liked to see each other when we were apart and talk. I don't know how to explain to you that the recklessness and disrespect that Anthony Saccone displays has taken the life out of me. How do I explain to you to where you can understand and know that my son, Michael Walker, is my perfect? Michael.
Michael, who only wanted to see everyone happy and treat everyone with love and respect. How do I explain to you that from the age of 8 or 9, Michael wanted to be an accountant because he was gifted with knowledge and understanding of numbers and would tell me that one day he was going to take care of me. I do not know how to tell you that Anthony Saccone has stolen my chance of becoming a grandparent with his actions and lack of respect. It is too difficult for me to even try to figure out how to deal with this because I will never get over that I will no longer see Michael. I will no longer be able to talk to Michael about anything, to hear him or FaceTime him. And please don't get me started on holidays and birthdays. My life has forever changed for the worse, all because of the actions of this defendant. He deserves to go to prison for the rest of his life. I will never in my life be able to speak to my perfect Michael again, and therefore he should receive a similar fate. What makes it even worse is that there is also two other families forced to live and share my pain, all because of this man. He did not just steal the unlimited potential of 3 young people, he robbed several families of their comfort with his thoughtlessness. There aren't enough words, enough years, enough anger to express what he has taken from us, or the wound that will forever ache and never heal. There is and cannot be any escape from this walking nightmare. So I say it again to you, Your Honor, I do not know how to do this, but I ask you in this court to give him the harshest sentence possible and to order restitution for causing the worst pain that any parent can go through.
Thank you.
I'd ask Kelly Myers to address the court on behalf of her daughter, Bailey Rose.
She would not have spent it doing laundry with Samara. She had things on her bucket list she wanted to accomplish. She wanted to ride in a hot air balloon, send a message in a bottle, go skydiving, swim with dolphins, ride in a helicopter, travel the world with her friends, find a cure for SIDS, learn a different language, and most of all, be successful. After working exceptionally hard to graduate a year early, she wrote herself a letter. Dear Bailey, 15 years ago from writing this in my American Lit class, senior year, having no clue what to write, because you just have no clue what to say to yourself or how you want to say it, because you don't know what you'll end up like or what your future is going to be like is kind of stressful. I was going through a lot. I was worrying about passing my classes, then my regents, overcome that. It was the best feeling ever. Now it's hard to me to answer the question, what do you want to do when you're older? Because when I lost my sister back in 2012, I realized that tomorrow was never promised. So will I even make it that far? Of course, I have to think positive, but that is just a daily thought I have to make me want to rethink my life and where I'm going to end up. As a senior in high school, I'm not sure what I want to do yet, but I want to make it. I don't know if that makes sense whatsoever, but hey, it's whatever. I just hope that I have been taking the right path and ended up where I'm supposed to be. I hope everything has ended up the way I wanted it to be. I had a hard time growing up, and the fact that I have no clue where I will be when I read this in 15 years kind of scares me. I want to have my first car by now. I want to be living in an apartment with my significant other, whether it's who I'm with now or not. I just want to make it. Life is full of obstacles. No matter what I have encountered in life, I've found myself to push through. Not giving up on yourself when you're completely down. It is one of the greatest things in the world. Perseverance is key. Fortunately, 15 years from now, Lady will never have the opportunity to read this letter to herself due to your actions. She never got to realize any of her dreams. If she had known that her trip to pick up Michael from work were her last moments, maybe she would have played her favorite song, rolled the windows down the field, frisked in her hair, or called to tell me she loved me. It's hard to comprehend that if she had been a little quicker, driven a little faster, she would still be here today. Your cars passing each other like two ships in the night. But she didn't speed because I taught her to drive, to respect the rules of the road, to be considerate, to be careful, especially with people like you, people who drive late at night, intoxicated, with no concern for the rules of the road, much less the other people who use them. And there are people who would argue that she shouldn't have been there, the people who ask, well, what were they doing out that late anyway? And the answer to that is simple, living life. Because the truth is that life shouldn't stop so that the roads are clear for people like you. There are people who are trying to work, like Michael, or people who have trouble sleeping, like Samra, and good friends like me who are out there driving and living and shouldn't be punished for your bad decisions. And as much as you, your friends, and your family try to play this out as some unfortunate accident, I respectfully disagree. This wasn't an accident, a completely unfortunate series of events that led us to this point. This was a series of bad decisions. You decided to drink to the point of excess. You decided as you hit that last stretch towards home to hit the accelerator until you reached over 80 miles per hour. You saw the red light and decided to try to go through it instead of stopping. But did you see them? Did you even bother to look? Quote, I know people are only human and make mistakes, but it's only a matter of a few days before that mistake kills someone. End quote. You said that in a Facebook post in 2012. Shame to the entire community that only applied that thinking to others and not yourself. It's hard to explain the impact of a loss of severe in a simple statement. How does one convey what it's like to feel a loss so completely that you question your entire being? For 19 years, I've been the mother of twins. The only person who feels that loss more thoroughly than I do is her twin sister. Her entire existence has revolved around being one half of a whole set. To know a person from the moment of conception is an honor. To accidentally be called her name after her death is a wound consistently reopened. Bailey almost wasn't there that night. She had made plans a month before to visit her Aunt Stacy in Florida. She would have left the week of the 19th, but she changed her mind. Her and Michael wanted to go with her younger sisters in the summer. She texted her aunt and told her that they wanted to be financially responsible and save money, get their bills in order. As a mother, I'm going to forever ask myself, what if? What if I had just bought their ticket? What if I had invited her to stay at my house at night? It's the what ifs that will continue to haunt me. My four-year-old daughter sometimes asks when Bailey is coming over. Sometimes it seems she understands that Bailey isn't coming back, but sometimes she asks about her visiting. And if the knowledge of her loss is just too much for her little mind to bear, her eight-year-old sister understands. Her mind takes comfort in crafts, painting in Bailey's honor. She's seen it before. Fate has seen it that Bailey's not the first child that I've had to bury. And despite my anger, the loss of a child is a pain I hope I never have to bear. Now our memories are reduced to rereading old text messages, watching videos just to hear her laugh. She'll never meet her nephew to whom she's supposed to be a godmother. She'll miss out on seeing her sisters grow up, and I'll never get to hold her again. I should have closed Bailey's casket. so anxious to get all the evidence for your case, evidence I've had the misfortune of getting to read. You hit her so hard the driver's seat ended up behind the passenger seat. She died on impact because you broke almost everything in her body. Her toxicology report was clean. She wasn't a perfect kid, but she was a good kid, and you robbed the world of her presence. We have been served a life sentence. We feel that Saccone should serve the maximum sentence for killing our children.
Thank you.
And Your Honor, McKenna Rose to speak on behalf of her twin sister, Bailey.
I've sat here over and over again trying to put into words how the loss of my identical twin sister, Bailey, has affected me. When I lost Bailey, I didn't just lose a twin, but I lost my best friend. The morning of Friday, February 23rd, 2018, continuously runs through my head. Think about the things I could have done to try and avoid what has happened, but in reality, there really isn't much that I could have done to save her or the others. The past 9 months have been nothing but pain. I've sat at every court date wondering what my family and the other two families have done to deserve something so horrible. I've sat in my bed until 6 in the morning, reading old text messages and looking at pictures and listening to videos of Bailey because I miss the sound of her voice and that goofy laugh she had. The pain of losing not only a loved one, but a twin sister is unbearable. Being a twin was so fun, but it's always something that I've always appreciated. Not everybody's lucky enough to say that they have an identical twin. Although we look so much alike, there were so many differences between us. She had this goofy laugh, and she loved having her nails done, and she always did her makeup. You knew who Bailey was when we were both together because she had this crazy personality. She was loud, but she was fun. We were so close, and we were inseparable. Bailey was always dedicated, and she was a role model to our two younger sisters who still look up to her to this day. She graduated a year early from high school, and I was so proud of herself for that. She wanted to do a lot with her life. If she wasn't happy with something, she would find a way to fix it. In May of 2017, she bought her first car. After saving paycheck to paycheck, she finally did it. She was determined to do something big in life. She wanted to finish school, and she wanted to become a nurse in a children's hospital, and eventually find a cure to SIDS, something that took her little sister away in 2012. She knew it was going to take time, but she knew she was going to do it. I told Bailey the night she passed away that she was going to be an aunt. As soon as I told her I was going to be having my first child, she said it better be a boy. I told her that she would be a godmother and that she was super excited to be there for me throughout my entire pregnancy and even be a part of my child's life. I gave birth to my beautiful baby boy on October 25th, 2018. Something that was supposed to be very exciting and happy turned out to be something so emotional and somewhat sad. I look at my son daily and I get upset that he's never going to be able to meet Bailey, somebody who wanted to be there for my son throughout his entire life and would have loved him unconditionally, was ripped apart from him so soon by such a selfish act. As excited as I am to tell my child all about his aunt and the memories that we have, I wish she was able to meet her. Bailey being ripped apart from me has caused a constant pain in my heart and a constant sadness. There are so many things I will never be able to watch Bailey do. I'll never be able to watch her walk down the aisle, and I'll never be able to watch her have her own children. I'll never be able to watch her graduate from college or do anything on her bucket list with her, and I'll never be able to be there for her when she buys her first house. There are so many things that were taken away from her. Visiting Bailey at a gravesite is one of the hardest places to be. I sit there and I talk to her, and I just wish that she was able to talk back to me. I was able to talk to Bailey about anything in the entire world, and she was always there for me. She may not have always agreed with the choices I made, but I knew she was there, and I always think of what she'd be doing right now. I miss her random texts to me throughout the day when she was at work just telling me that she missed me, and I miss her phone calls. I miss hanging out with her all day when she wasn't at work. I miss playing Uno with her and Michael, and the best part of playing with them was listening to them go back and forth and Michael made her draw too. I miss her goofy laugh, and I miss her crazy stories when she was at work, and there are so many things that I miss about her. I never knew somebody I didn't know would affect my life in such a horrible way. I always asked myself why Anthony Saccone thought it was okay to operate a vehicle drunk and high on cocaine. I also wonder why he would pull through a stoplight at 86 miles per hour, hitting my sister's car and running after doing something so horrible. I always wonder if he looked and called the cops, would my sister still be here? I hate knowing somebody hurt my sister so bad and I wasn't able to help her. I pray to God every day that she wasn't scared, that she knew I loved her, and that she knew that I was proud of her for everything she was doing with her life. And I hope she knew how thankful I was to have her as my twin sister. The night Bailey passed away, she called me and told me how she won $50 on a scratch-off ticket. I asked her how much she spent on it, and she told me $3. I laughed and said, "So you won $47. I'll never forget the little laugh she did. The last words I heard from Bailey were, "Okay, I love you, good night." Not knowing those were the last words that I have heard from her forever. Bailey was taken from me forever, and I will never be able to accept that. And then I would like to speak on behalf of our 8-year-old sister, Peyton. If I knew it was going to be my sister's death date, I would protect her off of the roads, along with her boyfriend Michael and her friend Samra. There was no way of knowing it was their time and place. There is never a time or place for your loved ones to leave you, and not for a day or a week, but forever. When I first heard about my sister's tragic death, I was devastated. There was no more Christmas or holidays with her. There was nothing left. We are never going to have those special moments with our loved ones again. There is never a right time for our loved ones to leave, but there is always a right time for them to say hi. There was no reason for these innocent children to leave their loved ones. When my loved one left, my heart stopped. When I saw a police officer at my doorstep, I knew we were not in the safe. When I heard dogs barking, I knew it was no ordinary person. It was an officer. This tragic death of my sister will not serve.
Your Honor, February 22nd and 23rd of this year initially were ordinary days for four people. Three of these people, Michael, Bailey, and Samra, who you in the last half hour have gotten to know as I have gotten to know them in the last 9 months. They were busy being the wonderful people that they were, not knowing that February 23rd would be the last day of their lives. They were studying, they were socializing, they were loving each other and enjoying each other's company. And in Michael's case, going to work in a late shift. While Michael was working, the fourth individual went about a normal day for him. He started off the evening festivities with some beers and a few games of pool, then some more booze with his friends, then topped that off with some cocaine, and then thought he would crown the evening with a visit to a local strip club, and then decided to have some more booze, and then get behind the wheel of a car and head home. And you can understand why the victims in this case will never refer to this as an accident. Bailey and her friend Samra are picking up Michael from something totally alien to the defendant, a job. It's early morning, the traffic is light, and Bailey is obeying the rules of the road driving home. I wish we could listen to them today and know what they were talking about, what they were hoping and planning. And as they approach the Onondaga Boulevard intersection, the light their way is green, and Bailey is driving the speed limit. This defendant, high on cocaine and alcohol, doesn't feel the need to wait for the red light his way. He begins to accelerate, his foot on the gas pedal, and that pedal to the floor of the vehicle, Your Honor. He more than doubles the posted speed limit. And in that split, horrible second, the intersection of fate and destiny meet, and he wipes out three lives. Bailey, forever 19, never to graduate, walk down an aisle, or raise her own family. Michael, forever 18, the absolute pride and joy of his mother, never to achieve again, or dream again, or spread the pure joy of his personality to others. And Samra, forever 20, never to light up a room again, never to teach us all what we can overcome if we simply dare to do it. Samra's high school teacher sent me an essay that Samra wrote. She had this debilitating disease, Your Honor, that took away her limbs. And in the essay that the teacher sent me, Samra is talking about a photograph of her 2 years old. I chose this picture because I was little and had my real arms and legs. But I'm not complaining. Can you imagine the beauty of a person to lose their arms and legs and never complain? I was one of a million to survive it because I have a great family and friends. My mom and sister have helped me through the most in my lifetime. They were the ones who stayed by my side when no one else would. And Anthony Saccone, having just wiped out three people, leaves his car, leaves the scene. He cares not a scintilla about what he's just done. And he cowardly flees to his mommy's house and goes upstairs and goes to bed. Judge, in cases like this, we often want the scales to balance. When a President Kennedy is killed by a pathetic loser like Lee Harvey Oswald, we want the scales to balance, but sometimes they don't. Here, we have three beautiful people. And on the other side, we have this defendant who was frankly not fit to be in the same room as them. As he once said in the hours of jail tapes that I and my staff have had to endure listening to, that he was sorry. We may see crocodile tears today, Judge. We may see crocodile tears 10 years from now. But I've come to know the real defendant. It's difficult to boil him down amidst all the racist, the homophobic, and the misogynistic rants that I've been forced to listen to over the last several months. But nothing tells more about this defendant than his words on May the 3rd, 2018, at 5:03 in the afternoon. They tell more about him than anything I could say or encapsulate about what he is all about. He says, quote, and I'll not use the exact language that he used, Judge, but you'll get the picture. Quote, I understand people lost their effing lives, but you know what? S-H-I-T happens. That tells you all you need to know about this defendant. Instead of asking to somehow, some way, take back that day, take back the irrevocability of what happened, he only tries to take back his plea. We in Onondaga County and these three beautiful families, Your Honor, have had enough of Anthony Saccone. I ask you to oppose the agreed upon sentence. And in the year 2028 and 2030 and 2032, up to and including 2046, when God willing, if I'm still alive, I will visit the parole board myself at the age of 94. I beg the parole board, listening to my words, to hear the words of Bailey and Michael and Sammer's families and keep this man locked up for as long as the law allows. And I thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Fitzpatrick. Mr. Sharp?
Your Honor, nothing I could say would lessen or ameliorate or alleviate the extraordinary loss, monumental loss, felt by the victim's family in this case. However, just as a matter of doing my job, I just note an exception to the court's ruling and ask that the court reserve my client's rights under the 4th, 5th, 6th, 8th, and 14th Amendments of the United States Constitution, Article 1, Section 6 of the New York State Constitution. I believe Mr. Saccone intends to speak.
And thank you, Mr. Sharp. Mr. Saccone?
Based on my life experiences, when someone lies to me, when caught in a lie, they can't be trusted. They lose all credibility. Well, Benarski and Fitzpatrick alike have both been caught lying in open court. They caught lying to the media. I can only imagine the lies Fitzpatrick has told these poor families behind closed doors. Everything he said is based off of lies, fraud, and deception. The only facts of truth or facts about evidence that he's decided to bring up based on his own speculation theories. Now, he wasn't there that night. There's only one man in this room who knows what truly happened that night. What happened is an absolute tragic story from point A all the way to point C. What happened was absolutely terrible. But to make a monster out of someone that he's never been in trouble a day in his life. People make mistakes. You can't, it's hard to convict and prove everything allege it against somebody with, I can't find the right word, Judge. You can imagine, everybody's under an extreme amount of pressure here. It's tough to speak in front of the cameras and in front of the crowd and everything. But how can we pass judgment based off a speculation theory and based off what he thinks what may or may not have happened that night? I think he's lost all his credibility. He can't be trusted. He's been caught lying once, twice, three times. How can we believe anything that comes out of his pageant's mouth? I was forced into taking this plea deal back in July 25th. I told my previous attorney more than once that I had a green light then. He chose not to represent me to the best of his ability. Partially, maybe because he was recommended by Fitzpatrick's wife. She recommended a lawyer that she knew that her husband could manipulate. They're friends. After I paid Sullivan, he threw a party at his house and invited Fitzpatrick over. What do you think they talk about? Well, they talk about how they could make an easy case, how they could both make some money, not represent Mr. Saccone, and let's just fast track this guy, railroad him right to the finish line, create someone to blame, and be done with it. It's not right, Your Honor. Like I said, the accident was nothing more than an accident. There was no malicious intent. I've never set out to hurt anybody in any way, shape, or form in my life. I am truly sorry for my involvement that night. But this man has gone directly against physical evidence and made up his own story about what he thinks may or may not have happened. And it's just 100% wrong. I had planned on saying much more, but I just can't think of the words for life. I'm deeply sorry for everything these families have been put through, up to including my involvement and everything that this district attorney has put them through. He's an actor. He's, quite frankly, he's a clown, but he expects people to believe what comes out of his mouth.
Hey, thank you, Mr. Saccone. This case has come to this point as a result of a plea agreement that was made between Mr. Saccone, his attorney at the time, the people of the state of New York, the district attorney's office, and was approved by this court, and this court is going to enforce that agreement today. Agreement that was negotiated by your prior attorney, Mr. Saccone, and frankly, an agreement that is sparing you the potential of many years in prison if you were convicted of the higher offenses. To some degree, that's been lost in the litigation that's occurred over the last few months. But first of all, the court has looked at the record of the plea, and the court affirms its decision again that the plea was knowingly, intelligently, and voluntarily made without any evidence of coercion. And it was an agreement that your prior attorney negotiated, and although it may not feel beneficial to you, was favorable to the defense and to you, Mr. Saccone, in many ways. I want to thank the families of Bailey and Michael and Samra who've been here at every court appearance, and those of you who spoke today. There's nothing that this court can say that really can lessen your pain in any way. But I want you to know that you have my sympathy, and I am very sorry for your loss. I appreciate your words today. I appreciate everything you've said. And I cannot imagine the pain that you've gone through as mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters and aunts and uncles suffering this tremendous loss. anyone can make a mistake. Anyone can make a series of bad decisions. Anyone can commit crimes. But this case illustrates, as much as any that I have seen in my 30 years as an attorney, that illustrates how one bad choice after another, after another, after another, with so many opportunities to stop, can result in just horrific loss. And I think it would be normal for the families of Bailey, Michael, and Samra to think to themselves, what could I have done to protect my son or daughter? What could I have done to protect my sister? And as Samra's younger sister, she spoke through today, as those words were relayed, she would have protected her sister. And I think everyone can understand that. But let me say this to you. When someone is a victim of a crime, whether it's a small crime or a crime like this that is just so vast and deep in its scope, there's nothing that you can do to avoid it. It's not your fault. Please don't blame yourselves. The responsibility for what happened on February 23rd, 2018 lies squarely at the feet of Anthony Saccone and no one else. Please remember that when you look back and you try to, and you have that thought of maybe blaming for yourselves of what you could have done to protect the members of your family and your loved ones. It's not your fault. It's Anthony Saccone's fault. Mr. Saccone, your comments today, in this court's mind, one of the most significant things from that night was the leaving the scene. And after what had happened, leaving those young people alone to die. Today you focused most of your comments on Mr. Fitzpatrick and other matters, but I suggest that it might be a little more beneficial to look inward and look at your own actions and evaluate that yourself, because it seems to this court that you just don't get it. Maybe someday you will. I hope that you do. Based upon your conviction by way of guilty plea, the sentence and judgment of this court is as follows. With respect to the third count in the indictment, operating a motor vehicle while ability impaired by the combined influence in alcohol and drug, which is a misdemeanor offense, the sentence and judgment of the court that you be sentenced to a 1-year incarceration sentence in the Onondaga County Correctional Facility. That sentence to be served concurrently, meaning at the same time as the other sentences the court is about to impose, and that will merge by operation of law. With respect to count 8 in the indictment, aggravated vehicular homicide, violation of section 125.14, subdivision 4 of the penal law of the state of New York, it's a sentence and judgment of the court that you be sentenced to an indeterminate sentence of 8 to 24 years in a New York State correctional facility. That sentence is to be served consecutively with the sentence in count 9, leaving the scene of an incident without reporting in violation of section 602A of the Vehicle and Traffic Law of the State of New York. Sentence on count 9, leaving the scene without reporting, is an indeterminate sentence of 2 to 6 years in New York State correctional facility. That sentence is to be served consecutively to the 8 to 24, which means an aggregate sentence of 10 to 30 years. The sentence on the first count is again concurrent with those sentences. There's also mandatory conditions with respect to these. Due to the nature of the offense, the court's imposing a 1-year license revocation along with the impaired driver program, the ignition interlock conditions. And the court is imposing mandatory fees and surcharges totaling $560. That concludes the sentence and judgment of the court. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The court will be in recess for a few minutes.